I'm so thankful for this privilege to stand before you today as your pastor and to launch out into a new series that I feel like God has placed on my heart. And this series is called Shalom, God's Peace and Purpose. God's Peace and Purpose, Shalom. Many of you have heard me say at the end of service, Shalom. That's how we greet one another when we're in the Holy Land. We just say Shalom. And it means peace, but it means so much more than that. And that's what we're going to explore in this series. And I'd like to ask that we just go before the Lord right now and ask for His touch. I'm just going to ask right now for you to stretch your hands this way towards me, and I'm going to stretch my hands towards you, and we're going to ask God to reveal Himself to us this morning. Can we do that right now? Hallelujah. Father, in Jesus' name, we're asking for your word to come alive in our hearts this morning. Oh God, that you would change us and transform us by the living word of God. And Father, that you would remove any false misconceptions about your word, and that you would establish us in your word. Hallelujah. Your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Your word we have hidden in our hearts that we may not sin against you. And so, Father, we're asking for your word to come alive in us. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, and that we would be changed by your word today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, when you look at this word shalom, your eyes may be a little unaccustomed to the Hebrew at the top, but that little thing that looks like a W is actually the first letter. So in Hebrew, we read from right to left. We read the opposite of how we're used to reading. Shalom starts left to right in English, but in Hebrew, we read right to left. And most of the ancient languages in the world were actually read from right to left. Ancient Chinese was right to left. Ancient Hebrew was right to left. And actually, scientists have determined that it's easier for the eye to read from right to left. So it's us folks, us English folks, that are making it a little more complicated, I guess. But that explains, Corky, why Hope, when she said, when she was little, and you asked her how she was doing, and she said, "Hey, mister, you've got any pockets?" And little Hope, she was about four, almost five, maybe five, and she said, "You got any money in them pockets?" And you pulled out a quarter, and you said, "Is this enough?" And she was used to the drink machine and the snack machine in the fellowship hall, and so she wanted enough to at least get a drink or at least get a snack, and the drinks and snacks were 50 cents. And she says, "No, that's not enough. I need 05. So she was reading it the right way, the Hebrew way, 05. Actually, it's 50 cents, but she was saying 05. And so then, Softy Corky, you reached in and gave her another quarter and kept her stocked for another day. And I appreciate that. Many people kept her stocked with Cheetos and Sprite. That was her favorite. And she'd come down the hall, and I'd see she'd have another Cheetos and another Sprite. And sometimes she had three every Sunday. And she was spoiled a little bit. But when we talk about God's shalom, shalom means so much more than peace. And this is the way that Hebrew people greet one another. And in fact, in John chapter 20, we see Jesus at different times using this terminology in John 20, verse 19, verse 21, and verse 26. And the terminology is Shalom Aleichem, peace be unto you, you plural. So in the South, we'd say peace be unto y'all, or Shalom y'all. That would be what we would say. And so Jesus said this three different times in John chapter 20. So I'm going to ask Donnie if he would put this up on the screen so you can follow along, but I'm going to read from the Jewish New Testament. The wording is going to be a little bit differently, but can you go ahead and put that up, Donnie? John chapter 20. But now this wording is a little different because this is the Jewish New Testament. So I'll begin reading with verse 19. In the evening that same day, the first day of the week, when the Talmidim, or disciples, were gathered together behind locked doors out of fear of the Judeans, Yeshua came, Yeshua is Jesus, stood in the middle and said, Shalom Aleichem. Having greeted them, he showed them his hands and his side. The Talmidim, disciples, were overjoyed to see the Lord. Shalom Aleichem, Yeshua repeated. Just as the Father sent me, I myself am also sending you. Now, this scripture, Hope used to call it the peace scripture, because every night before Hope went to bed, she would ask me to read the scripture, and there's more, and I'm going to read that more in a little bit. But she said, Daddy, would you read me the peace scripture? And the reason she said that is because Jesus over and over in this passage is saying, peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. Peace be unto you. Now, Hope was a light sleeper, and she often was up in the middle of the night, and oftentimes may have even had nightmares and different things. So she wanted me to read the peace scripture for her so that she would be able to go to sleep and have a peaceful night's rest. And so this peace scripture is more than just Jesus greeting the disciples. He says it more than once. He says, Shalom Aleichem. Now, maybe the disciples needed a double dose of peace because the resurrected Lord was appearing in a room that was locked, and he wasn't in there, and then he was in there. I mean, you know, he just showed up. And so he had a dramatic appearance, and it scared the living daylights probably out of the disciples. And so it took more than one Shalom Aleichem to calm them down, perhaps. Or perhaps there's more to it than that. But let's finish reading this passage. Sorry, I have to get my glasses out again. Having said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive Ruach HaKodesh, Holy Spirit. If you forgive someone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you hold them, they are held. Now Thomas, the name means twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Yeshua came. When the other Talmidim told him, We have seen the Lord, he replied, Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, put my finger into the place where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I refuse to believe it. A week later, his Talmidim were once more in the room, and this time Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Yeshua came, stood among them, and said, Shalom Aleichem. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here. Look at my hands. Take your hand and put it into my side. Don't be lacking in trust, but have trust. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Yeshua said to him, have you trusted because you have seen me? How blessed are those who do not see, but trust anyway. So three times in John 20, Jesus speaks peace to the disciples. Shalom Aleichem. Now, in the ancient world, we find in the book of Proverbs that people believed that there was power in their words. There was power in their words. In fact, Proverbs 18:21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. And you'll recall perhaps the story of Esther. A couple weeks ago, we celebrated Purim and the Feast of Esther. And in the story of Esther, when the king spoke words of judgment towards Haman, in the book of Esther, it actually says, his words left his mouth and covered Haman's face. Isn't that strange? We don't talk like that. We don't understand what that means. But the ancient people believed that our words have power, that our words speak life or death, that our words are a power or a force to be reckoned with. And so it should not surprise us then that Jesus spoke peace to his disciples very deliberately, very strongly, that he spoke peace to them. Shalom Aleichem. On three times in John 20. Now, when Jesus spoke this, what was he saying? It's more than just peace. It's more than just our concept of peace. Remember, we talked about how that in certain languages, words can mean more than one thing, or it may take more than one word to translate a certain word. And shalom is one of those words that can't just be translated by any one English word. It's amazing. The concept of shalom is powerful. And so when we talk about shalom, we're talking about many facets of peace. So let's look at some of those facets today, and let's see what the word shalom actually meant to the Jews. First of all, it meant safety and security. Safety and security. Job 5:24 says, you will know that your tent is secure. And that word secure is actually shalom. You will take stock of your property and find nothing missing. So shalom has to do, can have to do, with your household and the safety and security of your household. So when you say shalom, you're speaking safety and you're speaking security. But it doesn't just mean safety and security. It also can mean soundness of body. Soundness of body. Psalm 38:3 says, no peace, no shalom is in my bones because of my sin. In other words, the psalmist was struggling with his sin and he was needing to get right with God. And he recognized that until he got right with God, until he dealt with his sin, that there was not going to be any shalom in his body, in his bones. And this may sound a little weird to us or a little creepy to us, but actually, you and I both know that when we're in sin, it takes a toll on our body. Stress takes a toll on our body. Sinful ways takes a toll on our body. And so when we finally get right with God, we're not only at peace with God, but even our bodies can experience the touch of God. Now, maybe you guys have never done this, but there have been many times where I've been struggling physically, and I've asked the Lord, "Lord, is it a sin problem? Have I done something wrong? Have I blown it? Will you please show me what I've done so that I can get right with you?" But then, if the problem persists and I don't feel like that I've done anything to bring it on myself, and I feel like I'm right with God and I feel like I'm right with everyone else, there comes a time when I have to speak to it. And I have to say, "Fever, be broken in the name of Jesus. Sickness, be gone in the name of Jesus. Disease, be gone from my body in the name of Jesus. Satan, the Lord rebuke you, be gone from me in the name of Jesus." Now I know that sounds kind of weird. That sounds a little, unusual. But I believe we've got authority in Christ Jesus. And we can speak peace to the storms that are taking place with our body. We can speak peace to those storms in Jesus' name. We can take authority over our bodies. We can take authority over sickness and disease in Jesus' name. And many times, we can just go ahead and pray for ourselves. In Jesus' name. Now, if that doesn't work, then you need to call for the elders of the church and have them lay hands on you. But how many of us call the elders before we've prayed for ourselves? Hey, you don't have to call the elders all the time. We don't mind if you call. We're on call. But you don't have to call the elders every time. Hey, God has put you authority over, He's given you authority over your body. He's given you authority over your house. And you can pray for yourself in ways that we can't even pray for you. And so you may need to take a stand and take that authority in Jesus Christ and pray over yourself. And see God do the work through you. And that increases your faith. When you see God answer your prayers, you see God moving on your behalf, that increases your faith to believe God even more. Amen. Amen. Well, I don't know if I'm going to... Well, I guess I better just move on. I guess I better just move on. Now, shalom also means overall welfare. And in Genesis 29, verse 6, Jacob has fled from his family, and he has caught up with Laban, the family of Laban. And he's inquiring about Laban. And so then Jacob in 29:6 says, "Then Jacob asked them, 'Is he well?'" But the way that is in Hebrew is shalom to him. Is shalom to him? Now, we all have different ways of greeting one another in our culture. "How you doing, Pastor?" "Fine. How are you?" "Fine." In China, when I would when I was there for a year, and we would greet one another as we were passing by each other. The Chinese would say, "Chafan Lama, Chafan Lama," and that was, "Have you eaten yet?" That's my kind of culture. It's centered around food. "Chafan Lama," and the way you would respond was, "Chaguola, I've already eaten," or "I'm on my way to eat," or in other words, you tell them about your next meal or your past meal, one or the other. So, "Chafan Lama, have you eaten yet?" "Chaguola, I've already eaten." And you just keep on going. Well, in Hebrew, shalom. Is shalom to him? Is shalom to him? He's asking about Laban. Is shalom to him? And they replied, "Shalom." In other words, he's great. He's doing well. He's doing wonderful. And we don't have that concept when we're dealing with folks. But we kind of do the same thing. "How are you doing?" "I'm doing well." "How are you doing?" "I'm doing well too." And that's the basic same meaning. With the well-being, the overall welfare has to do with shalom. And so that's also what shalom means. And then it also means prosperity. Prosperity. Psalm 122, verses 6 through 9. Pray for the shalom of Jerusalem. Why don't we just turn and face Jerusalem right now? Pray for the shalom of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Shalom be within your walls, prosperity in your towers. For the sake of my brethren and my companions, I will now say, shalom be within you. For the sake of the house of Yahweh our God, I will seek your good. So this shalom has to do with the prosperity of Jerusalem. And when we pray for the prosperity and the peace, the shalom of Jerusalem, we're praying for its overall prosperity. But then it also means tranquility and contentment. Tranquility and contentment. Let me open up my other Bible. Isaiah chapter 32, verse 17 and 18. The fruit of righteousness will be shalom, peace. The effect of righteousness will be quietness and confidence forever. My people will live in peaceful dwelling places, in secure homes, in undisturbed places of rest. Isn't that beautiful? Doesn't that describe the way you would want to live? Well, that's what shalom is. It's tranquility and contentment. But it also means peace from war. Peace from war. Joshua 9, verse 15 says, "Then Joshua made a treaty of peace with them to let them live." And so it means peace from war. And so whenever there's war, there can be peace if the two sides agree to it. Now, sometimes we find folks who are always advocating for peace, but as my good friend Rabbi Michael Weiner says, shalom is not just the absence of war. Shalom is the presence of God. And so when you've got the presence of God, that's what matters. And sometimes there has to be wars, but when you seek the presence of God, He is Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace. He is Tsar Shalom, the Prince of Peace. And so it may involve some wars at some time, but when you seek Him, you seek His presence. That's when you can have shalom. But shalom also can mean peace from war. It also can mean peace between people. Zechariah 6, verse 13 says, "And he will be priest on his throne, and there will be harmony," that word is shalom, "between the two." Harmony between the two. Turn to your neighbor and say shalom. Now, you shouldn't say it unless there's harmony between the two of you. So, husbands and wives, if you fought on the way to church, now's the time to get right. Shalom. There's got to be harmony between you and other people. John said, if a person doesn't love his brother, if he hates his brother and claims to love God, he's a liar. So there's got to be harmony, there's got to be shalom, not just between you and God, but between you and everyone else, as much as it is possible with you. And so Paul said, as much as it is possible with you, live at peace with all men. So you've got to establish that harmony between you and with everyone else, even if it means apologizing, even if it means humbling yourself, even if it means, well, you need to take the high road. You need to do what it's going to take without compromise in order for there to be harmony between you and everyone else as much as it is possible with you. But this also, shalom also means peace with God. Peace with God. Isaiah 54:10, "Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed." My covenant of shalom. God has made His covenant of shalom. And no matter what happens all around you, no matter what is swirling all around you, even if the mountains are shaken and the hills are removed, God's covenant of peace stands. God's covenant of peace remains. And no matter what is trying to shake you up at the moment, you've got to cling to His covenant. His covenant is a covenant of shalom. His covenant that is a covenant that will stand. And no matter what you're facing, no matter how hard things may be, when you cling to Him and you cling to His covenant of shalom, you can stand in the face of adversity and difficulty in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. So, in number 6, the priests would speak a blessing over the people of Israel. And this blessing was powerful. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And this blessing was powerful. In fact, at the end of this, in Numbers chapter 6, beginning with verse 22, down in 27, God says, "So they will put my name on the Israelites, and I will bless them." In other words, when the priests spoke this, the way that God looked at it was that they were speaking His name and putting his name on all of the people of Israel whenever they spoke it. And so when they spoke peace, it was more than just words. And when they speak, when they spoke a blessing, the people received the blessing. And so when they received the blessing, that means that it was more than just words. It means that God was involved in this blessing. And this blessing was a blessing of power. And this blessing was a blessing of shalom. This blessing was a blessing of peace. And if someone receives it, it can be powerful in their lives. So listen to what it says. Verse 22. Yahweh said to Moses, "Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Say to them, Yahweh bless you and keep you. Yahweh make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Yahweh turn his face toward you and give you peace." Shalom. "So they will put my name on the Israelites, and I will bless them." So this wasn't just the priests giving a blessing to the people. God said that when the priests give this blessing, that he would bless. When the priests would give this blessing, that he would bless. And when the priests spoke the name of God, that and they put the name on the people, that God would honor that and God would bless the people. Now, I know this sounds unusual in terms of the way that we understand things, but according to the ancient world, this was very common. And so when the priest spoke this blessing, the people got ready. Why? Because God was going to bless them. Now, we call that faith now. When the priest spoke the blessing, the people got ready for God to bless them. Why? Because he said he would. He said, "I will bless them. I will bless them." So did we take God at his word? Do we take God at his word? Do we believe that God will bless us? I'm glad five of you do. Now, I'm not talking about this being some type of magic incantation, okay? I'm not talking about that. What I'm talking about is God giving authority when his priest spoke in his name. That carried the authority of God. Now, we've all been made priests through Christ. We've been made a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, a people belonging to God. Hallelujah. We've become a holy priesthood. We don't have to go through any priest anymore for our blessing. We serve the great high priest, Jesus. Hallelujah. And he has bought our redemption on the cross of Calvary. He has shed his blood and is now the great high priest who is ever living and making intercession for us. Aren't you thankful that we have a great high priest, Jesus? And so we now can speak with the authority of Jesus. Now hold on, Philip. Hold on. Isn't that a little presumptuous? to say that we can speak with the authority of Jesus? Well, what are we? We are Christians. 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 Yens are Christians? Okay. I thought I'd use a little bit of local lingo. So, Christians, Christians, are followers of Christ. Jesus Christ is the Messiah, the anointed one, and we, through him, have now become his anointed ones. Now we have an anointing. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, by the blood of Jesus, we have also become the anointed of God. And so we have been given his name. Hallelujah. At the name of Jesus. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and of things under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. We have been given a name. We have been given the most powerful name under heaven. And Jesus said in Matthew 28:18, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and in earth. And now he has given us that same authority, and so we can now speak in his name with his authority, and we can bless. We can bless in the name of Jesus. We can speak peace in the name of Jesus, and it carries the same weight as when he speaks it himself, because he's given us his authority. And in the name of Jesus, when we speak with his authority, we are his royal ambassadors, we are his royal delegates, and when we speak, we carry the authority of Jesus. And so now, we can speak his name with authority, and we can bless with authority, and we can speak his shalom, his peace, with authority. And so the question is not, is he going to bless? Because he already said that he would. The question is, do we believe it? The question is, do we receive it? The question is, are we going to walk out our faith, or are we just going to sit and say, that sounds good, but never receive it in our hearts? So, I'm going to ask you all to do something a little strange. Go figure. Y'all are used to that by now. I'm going to ask in just a moment that we all gather down here at the front. And I am going to speak the priestly blessing over us. Now, that's not because I think that I am the high priest. But I know the high priest. His name is Jesus. And I have also been made a priest. And so I believe that I can speak this with authority. And I believe that we can all speak this with authority. And we can speak peace, tranquility, contentment, right relationships, healthy bodies. We can speak soundness and safety and security. We can speak the shalom of God. And the question is not, is God going to bless in that way? The question is, are we going to receive it? So, would y'all gather with me up front here? And I want to speak this blessing over us. Now, when I speak this, I want us to prepare our hearts, because the Word says that God's going to bless. So we have to have open hearts. Y'all kind of squeeze in. We've got several trying to get up a little closer. Yeah, thank you. So let's prepare our hearts as if God Himself were speaking this to us. As if God Himself were speaking this to us. Now, I'm not claiming to be God. You guys understand that. But I'm thankful through the shed blood of Christ, I've been adopted into His royal family, heirs of God, joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And so now I can speak in His name with His authority, and I can expect God to bless as if He had spoken it Himself. Why? Because He has spoken it. And He has already delegated His authority and His blessing. And so now all we have to do is speak it and receive it and walk it out. So let's pause and prepare to receive this word. Father, we quiet ourselves in Your presence. And we prepare to receive the living Word of God. We prepare to receive Your blessing. We prepare to receive Your shalom. In the name of Jesus. Now let's lift up our hands to receive. Yahweh bless you and keep you. Yahweh make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Yahweh turn His face towards you and give you shalom, peace. Thank you, Father. Father, we have heard this blessing. And You have promised to perform this blessing. So now, by faith, we receive this blessing in the name of Jesus. We receive, hallelujah, the blessing of God. We receive the keeping of God. We receive the face of God shining upon us. We receive Your grace, hallelujah. We receive Your face being turned towards us. We receive You giving us Your shalom, Your peace. We receive it, oh God. We receive it in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Can we just thank Him? Thank Him. Hallelujah. We thank You, Lord. We thank You, Lord. We thank You, God. We thank You, God. Now, before we leave, you also are priests of God, right? We've been made a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, a people belonging to God. We all have been made priests with God. Now, I don't think it was any accident that the last word of this blessing is shalom. I don't think it's an accident. You know why? Because every time we say shalom to one another, we activate this blessing from God. As shalom has been given to us, as shalom has been spoken over us, as shalom has been activated in our lives, He doesn't give it to us just to sit and soak and sour. Oh, I got peace. I got peace. I got peace. Well, that's good. But why did He give you the peace? Not just for you. He gave you that peace to share with everyone else all around you. And so now we are His agents of peace. We are His voice of peace. We are His voice of blessing. We have been made priests, and we speak with the authority of Christ. We speak with the authority of the Word of God. And whenever we say shalom, we believe that life and death, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and we choose to speak life. We choose to speak shalom. We choose to speak peace. We choose to speak tranquility. We choose to speak contentment. We choose to speak peace from war. We choose to speak safety. We choose to speak security. We choose to speak prosperity. We choose to speak the shalom of God into the lives of our brothers and sisters in the name of Jesus. So you and I are now His agents to speak this shalom to the world. Not just amongst us, but to everyone in the world. We want to speak the shalom of God to everyone in the world. So I'm going to ask before we leave, instead of praying a benediction, I want you to speak the benediction. I want you, if you feel led, if you feel comfortable, and even if you don't feel comfortable, why don't you try it anyway? Because you are a priest, and this is what priests do. So, would you speak shalom to, just a minute, don't. I'm glad for you being ready. But would you speak God's shalom to at least two or three or four or five people before you leave today and speak it with authority? And you've received this now, right? You've received this shalom. So go ahead and share it with everybody around you and speak the shalom of God. God bless you. Shalom.